Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, it's both a privilege and honor to welcome you all at this special virtual event. I'm delighted for this opportunity to share thoughts about the most recent development in Kazakhstan and discuss the measures taken by our government to tackle COVID-19 and its aftermath. To begin with, I would like to thank Mr. Tom Nagorski, Executive Vice President for Asia Society, for hosting this timely discussion. Last month, President of Kazakhstan, His Excellency Kasym-Jomart Tokayev, in his statement addressed at the general debate of the 75th session of the UN General Assembly, called upon the international community to take concrete steps in facing global challenges and share his vision of the prospects for economic recovery. The global pandemic remains the greatest challenge that causes deep suffering among the people around the world and seriously affects the world economy. It has become a stress test not only for our humanitarian values, but also for the multilateral system itself. Partnership has become a key term in the time of the pandemic. We express our solidarity with the U.S. in fighting with COVID-19. Taking this opportunity, I would like to thank the U.S. government for its support of Kazakhstan's emergency response to the pandemic. COVID-19 has demonstrated that in the modern world, any local challenges may become global, and the international community needs to enhance coordination among regional and international stakeholders. The pandemic has increased the global need for humanitarian assistance and exchange of the best practices. Protectionism was the initial natural response of the international community to the spread of the pandemic. Now it's important to revive interaction in order to ensure the unrestricted and smooth flow of goods, food, and critical supplies. Since Kazakhstan has been heavily affected by the coronavirus pandemic, along with many other countries across the world, let me briefly tell you about the COVID-19 situation in our country. Our government of Kazakhstan took comprehensive measures to restrain the outbreak and maintain social and economic stability. Two packages of emergency anti-crisis measures have been adopted. More than 4.5 million Kazakhstanis who temporarily lost their income have received assistance in the total amount $1.1 billion. Over a million people have received food and household packages. Currently, we have managed to stabilize the situation. Thanks to the timely quarantine measures, Kazakhstan has been able to contain the spread of pandemic. To overcome the negative consequences of COVID-19, our government adopted a joint plan aimed at the maintaining employment and supporting small and medium-sized enterprises. The total amount allocated by government to mitigate the outcomes of pandemic was around 9% of the country's GDP, which is $15.64 billion. We drafted the strategic development plan until 2025. It will determine our economic course for medium term, including further economic reforms. As a part of response to the pandemic, the government has increased focus on turning to knowledge-based economy. Committed to safety and security in Central Asia, Kazakhstan does not stand aside and provided food and humanitarian supplies to its neighbors, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, and Afghanistan. We also allocated a voluntary financial contribution to the United Nations Global Humanitarian Response Plan, which will be aimed at combating the pandemic in Afghanistan. Building a long-term economic resilience is our top priority. Kazakhstan continues to make a business environment more transparent and attractive to foreign investors. As noted by many financial analysts, despite a significant drop in oil price and the imposition of quarantine measures, Among all CIS countries, Kazakhstan showed one of the leading results in the resisting external shocks, as its GDP decreased only by 1.8% in annual terms in the first half of 2020. Located at the heart of Eurasia, Kazakhstan is the largest economy in the region that was ranked 25th in the World Bank Doing Business 2020 report. COVID-19 could prove to be a turning point for the contact-free economy. We stimulate companies to invest in e-commerce, telemedicine, and automation. We are building a reliable, affordable, high-speed, secure digital infrastructure in the framework of a national program Digital Kazakhstan. With its unique geographic location, Kazakhstan has access to the entire Eurasian market. Kazakhstan serves as an important transport hub connecting east and west, north and south. Over 70% of transcontinental routes go through our country. Further transforming Kazakhstan as a financial hub in Central Asia, we established the Astana International Financial Center, which adopts the best practice of American institutions and based it on principles of the English common law. Nasdaq and Goldman Sachs have become shareholders in the Astana International Exchange and modern trade platform in Central Asia. Regional cooperation features among the main priorities of Kazakhstan foreign policy. Kazakhstan is committed to the principles of equality and mutually beneficial cooperation in its relation with all Central Asian states. In order to strengthen our regional engagement with the international community, we have established a C5+1 dialogue format with the United States, EU, China, Japan, and South Korea that laid a very good foundation to maintain trust-based dialogue and practical interaction among the participants. The C5+1 dialogue platform has become a key factor of regional cooperation between Central Asia and the United States. We value our partnership and look forward to working hand in hand to ensure stable and prosperous Central Asia. Strong Central Asia correlates with the US long-term interest. Since 2018, we introduced the practice of regular consultative meetings of head of states of Central Asia and clearly see both political will and eagerness to deepen regional interaction. The sustainable and dynamically developing economy of our region helps assist reconstruction and rehabilitation of Afghanistan. We see Afghanistan as an important partner with historic links to Central Asia. Kazakhstan commends the US leadership in the peaceful resolution of conflict through the inter-Afghan dialogue. We welcome signing in February 2020 the agreement for bringing peace to Afghanistan between the United States and Taliban and inter-Afghan talks recently initiated in Doha. In turn, Kazakhstan over the past 20 years has been actively involved in promoting peace and stability in Afghanistan through its assistance to national security forces, infrastructure development, education, empowerment of women, and many more. We firmly believe that constructive political dialogue is vital to ensure trade, economic investment, and people-to-people interaction. We see Afghanistan as an attractive development partner with large potential to be integrated into the region. We believe that joint efforts by all key stakeholders should be mutually reinforcing and synergetic. Despite the pandemic, Kazakhstan is not slowing down when it comes to our political modernization. The human rights and dignity are top priority in President Tokayev's political agenda, which he emphasized in the recent State of the Nation address. President Tokayev pays a special attention to political reform aimed at democratization and strengthening the dialogue between society and government. He clearly outlined his key principle of leadership, that is, no economic growth without political development. This year, the first package of democratic reforms, including expanding rights to form political parties, promote religious freedom and peaceful assembly, and decriminalization defamation, has been successfully implemented. We have abolished the death penalty in Kazakhstan. We also provided for mandatory 30% quota for women and youth in the election party lists. These are the most profound political reforms in the country's history. These changes are irreversible and evolutionary in nature. Political activism is now a norm in public life. President initiated establishment of the National Council of Public Trust. This institution provides unique opportunity for independent experts, civil and human rights activists, non-governmental organizations to take active part in the process of drafting the legislation. To continue the effective implementation of reforms, the creation of agency for strategic planning and reforms that reports directly to the president was announced in the early September of this year. On top of that, Supreme Council for Reforms has been created under the leadership of the President Tokayev. In brief, the formula for Kazakhstan's state governance is a strong president, influential parliament, and accountable government. We firmly believe that this concept of political system meets the needs of our country in the best way and ensures its stable and sustainable future. The religious freedoms have always been part of our culture in Kazakhstan. We are probably the largest country with Muslim majority that has become a safe home for Jewish community. Despite the pandemic, we welcomed more than 200 Jewish pilgrims in Almaty to visit the gravesite of the Rabbi Levi Yitzhak Shirson. To continue with the effective implementation of the launched political and economic reforms, we are committed to working with our partners. In 2021 will mark the 30th anniversary of Kazakhstan's independence and the 30th anniversary of diplomatic relations between Kazakhstan and the United States. The U.S. became the first country to recognize our independence back in 1991. Since that, relations between our countries have been strengthened in constructive spirit, which can be characterized as a reliable, perspective, and predictable partnership. The enhanced strategic partnership between Kazakhstan and the United States, established during the visit of the first President Nazarbayev to the United States in 2018, paved the way to further broadening of investment, trade, and economic cooperation between our countries. During his visit to New York in September 2019, President Tokayev held a series of bilateral meetings with major stakeholders of American business and leading U.S. experts. President reaffirmed his commitment to deepen the enhanced strategic partnership between our countries. Our cooperation extends to the parliamentary level as well. We are glad to see these ties grow with the establishment of the U.S.-Kazakhstan Congressional Caucus. As a benchmark of our excellent cooperation in security and defense areas, we would like to note the recent success story of the Jusan humanitarian operation that made possible to repatriate about 600 Kazakh citizens from Syria with the support of our American partners. In 2019, direct U.S. investment into Kazakhstan set a new record of $6 billion U.S. dollars, and mutual trade between our nations nearly doubled. Currently, over 500 American companies operate in Kazakhstan. As a practical step to help American companies to do business in Kazakhstan, we opened the new Consulate General in San Francisco and signed an open skies agreement to enable direct flights between our countries. Energy cooperation has been a backbone of our economic engagement. We appreciate our cooperation with Chevron, ExxonMobil, Honeywell, and others. Currently, we are exploring the best opportunities in agriculture and high-tech industries, expanding our partnership with major US agricultural companies like Tyson Food and Valmont in spheres of meat processing and irrigation. In cooperation with the US Development Financial Corporation, we look forward to exploring even more opportunities to launch joint investment projects in Kazakhstan. As one of the venues of cooperation, we suggest the Astana International Financial Center, which has all necessary infrastructure. This is all saying, stating that in crisis comes an opportunity. The US-Kazakhstan enhanced strategic partnership has never been stronger. We look forward to further strengthening bilateral relations and expanding our economic cooperation with the United States. This is a brief overview of our current state of affairs, and I would be delighted to hear your assessments and views as well as exchange of opinions. Thank you.
Minister, thank you so much for your remarks. You've given us a lot to cover here. I appreciate in particular, and I'm sure our audience does as well, your points about accountable government, religious freedoms and the like, but really it's you've given us a great tour, not only of the region, but also of what's happened in your country in the wake of the pandemic. And perhaps I can start with a couple of questions there. And I realize that, you know, dealing with a pandemic inside your borders is not necessarily something that typically comes to the desk of a minister for foreign affairs, but since you raised it, you made a statement that I thought was particularly interesting, and let me see if I quote you correctly, that COVID-19 and the virus had produced, quote, a stress test for our, not only for our humanity and values, but also for the multilateral system itself. And I wonder how you think, if it has been a test for the multilateral system, how do you think the world is doing? I realize that's a very big question, but how would you grade the performance of that system? And what do you think needs to be done, whether it's regionally or globally, to improve on the global reaction if we are to face something like this in the future?
No, definitely, the coronavirus pandemic give damages to the process of globalization. As we can see nowadays, the state borders between the countries become closed, and the process of the unification of international law also is under critics. And as well, the many international organizations show not so as we want the effectiveness. So what we can do now, it's to unify the whole countries and to strengthen the effectiveness of the international organizations, and definitely first of all is the United Nations. And as we can hear from the all head of states and governments who delivered statements in at the 75th meeting of the UN General Assembly, they call upon to reform, to make reforms in the United Nations system. But generally, we don't have alternatives such organization as the UN on the global framework.
Thank you, Minister. And back to your country specifically, you've said, and it's clear that Kazakhstan has been able to stabilize the situation. You have had, I believe, as have a lot of countries, a little bit of a return or a rise in cases and incidence of the virus, either because the rules get relaxed a little bit or perhaps because the citizens don't pay attention to the rules as much as they should. How concerned are you at the moment about either a second wave or this process or phenomenon that the reopening such as it is, starts to bring another rise in cases?
Indeed, the second wave of the COVID-19 nowadays spreading, especially in Europe. So, as we can see, in many cases, countries could not introduce again the lockdown in total, because first of all, the economy of these countries and our countries definitely suffering from the lockdown, total lockdown. So therefore, we need to introduce more quarantine measures and more explain to our citizens that we need the, some elementary rules of the clearness and the hygiene. And also, definitely all countries need to unify for the as soon as possible to produce the vaccine against the coronavirus. So our scientists also working on this, and just recently they presented the anti-coronavirus vaccine, and now we started the testing stages. And as our scientists promise us, in February we can come to the industrial production of this vaccine.
Really? Well, that's something I did not read about in my preparation. So are you saying, sir, that there may be, at least in your country, a vaccine produced by Kazakhstan for the people of Kazakhstan in just 4 or 5 months' time?
Yes, I hope so. And we congratulate our Russian partners. They already registered a vaccine. So, and we have got negotiations with the Russian government also for the buying of the Russian vaccine. As well, at the same time, we're working with the Chinese government, which is now also cooperating with United Emirates to develop also vaccine against the COVID-19. So we try to keep on different tracks to get as soon as possible the vaccine.
Yeah, well, it's as you know, sir, something of a global race, and I certainly wish you and your country well on that front. One more COVID-related question, if I may. I gather that that the government, your government, is considering or has considered reimposing some restrictions on flights. And I guess the question there is, even as you manage the pandemic in your country, in terms of the outbreaks, how concerned are you about the situation in neighboring countries, particularly your Central Asian neighbors, as we get into this next phase of the pandemic?
No, definitely the opening, reopening the air flights between countries is a both side decision. So definitely our neighboring countries watching the situation in Kazakhstan with the coronavirus as well. We are also taking into account what the situation in our neighboring country. Like with Russia, we reopened flights, regular air flights, but with less frequencies. Also, for nowadays, we have air flights with Russia, Germany, Turkey, South Korea, and Uzbekistan, as well with Kyrgyzstan. So, and upon the suggestion and decision of our Ministry of Healthcare, we consider to expand the opening. But as we can see nowadays, the second wave of the COVID-19 is spreading around. So we should make it slowly but surely.
You mentioned something, Minister, in your remarks that caught our attention, moving towards, where possible, a contact-free economy. I think you mentioned this is, of course, something being discussed in other places. The economy of your country, of course, is so rooted, first and foremost, in the fossil fuel industry. You mentioned the land routes that have been historically so important for Kazakhstan, of course, and those are all about contact, right? So I wonder if you can maybe elaborate or expand a little bit on what would be some examples in terms of shifting to a new paradigm or elements that would exist in a contact-free economy.
Yes, on one side, the COVID-19 made damage to the national economies, but on other side, it's opened opportunities for some areas in economy. Like as we watching these days, telecommunication and IT technologies developing very fast. This is one of the most profitable sector of our economy. So this gives impetus to develop sectors of economy which can actively use digital technologies. So nowadays we start the our national program to develop e-commerce. And nowadays in the framework of, as I mentioned, the national program digital of Kazakhstan, the e-commerce becoming as one of the main pillars. And nowadays we are working very closely with the Chinese government to use more e-commerce in the turnover between our two countries.
Thank you. We have some questions coming in from our audience. I'll get to them in a moment, and we'll move now, I guess, beyond your borders, if we may. And you mentioned, you spoke a bit about Afghanistan in your remarks as, among other things, an attractive partner for development for your country. And you spoke also of welcoming the negotiation process that has been underway for some time. One thing I don't think you mentioned was the potential for the departure of American forces. I mean, they have been drawing down for some time now. As you know, President Trump said recently that they will be all gone by the end of this year. And I wonder, sir, if you can speak to your own feelings or your country's feelings about the departure of U.S. and international forces as part of an agreement. Does that, do you think that would be a good thing? Do you worry at all about any kind of vacuum in power or stability if those troops were to leave entirely?
Yes, indeed, as a region neighboring to Afghanistan, we interest in the stabilization, the situation in this country. And for nowadays, the U.S. military forces provide this kind of situation under the control. And that's why definitely there is a lot of worries about that U.S. Military forces will be taken out from this country. But as we're watching the current U.S. administration taking care about this, so we welcome the negotiations in Doha with Taliban movement, and because this provide the good ground for the inter-Afghani talks.
So basically, if as a result of those negotiations, the American forces go, you would welcome that.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's get to a couple of these questions. Not surprisingly, I suppose, Minister, questions are coming in about the two giant countries that Kazakhstan lives with and near, namely Russia and China. A question comes in about the Belt and Road Initiative in particular, of course, the unprecedented, enormous infrastructure project that the Chinese have been busy with for a long time. Question is, could the minister give an update on Belt and Road Initiative projects in Kazakhstan? Some of those projects associated with the BRI have run into problems elsewhere, and it is hard to imagine the land portion of the BRI working without Kazakhstan.
Kazakhstan supports the Belt and Road Initiative from the beginning. And as you know, as maybe you know, this initiative for the first time was announced here in Kazakhstan, in our capital. Yeah. And definitely, the challenge for Kazakhstan is in the landlockedness. So Kazakhstan is a landlocked country. So that's why definitely we consider which way we can be connected to the international maritime transports. And that's why we need to use more our transit transport potential of our geographical location. So we consider that Kazakhstan can serve for the connectivity between Asia and Europe. That's why we consider that BRI provides such a kind of opportunities. But what we have our own national program for the infrastructure development. We call it Nurlu Yol. And after the BRI was introduced to by China, we tried to adjust this to program in one project. So for now, nowadays, six international motorways and five international railways goes through the Kazakhstan and connecting East China with the West Europe. So we trying to get the all profits and to make it these projects mutually beneficial for Kazakhstan and for our partners.
Thank you. And sticking with China for a moment, but now turning to relations between China and the United States. And of course, I don't need to tell you, nor probably most of our audience, that U.S.-China relations are now at perhaps a low not seen since things were normalized more than four decades ago between the two countries. And your country, of course, maintains, as you've said, very close and very important relations with both countries. And I wonder whether it's the decline in that relationship or perhaps the trade issues in particular. You know, it's often said that when two big nations fight, and I don't mean literally fight, but neighbors and other countries in between can suffer. How concerned are you about that relationship? To what extent does it impact what you, your own policy making, and particularly your relations with China and the U.S.?
Indeed, any tension between the United States, Russia, China, and the European Union makes damage to the development of our region. For example, if you will see will look on the map, you can see that on the north we have Russia, which is under the sanctions of Western country and also Belarus under sanctions. As well, we have some tension between Ukraine and Russia. On the east part, we have China, which is, as you just mentioned, that have some difficult trade discussions with the US. On the south part, we have Afghanistan with its instability. Also, we have tensions between India and Pakistan, India and China. And on the west part, we have Iran, which is also under the sanctions. And as well, nowadays, we are witnessing the military conflict between Armenia and Azerbaijan. So as you can see, we surrounded with all these sanctions and trade wars. So what we can see, what we can do in this situation. So in this time, we can see that the new trends happening in the Central Asia. So these trends bring us to the regional integration. We started in 2018 with the consultative meetings of the head of states of all five Central Asian states in Nur-Sultan City. The second meeting was in Tashkent last year. So our leaders decided to have these regular meetings and to discuss our common issues. And it was agreed also to sign the agreement between all five countries about the friendly and mutually beneficial relations. So that shows that we understand that as a region, we should integrate and cooperate with each other. Considering these new trends, our partners also would like to consider us as a one international subject. Just I mentioned that we opened new dialogue platforms, C5 plus. So C5 means five Central Asian states with US, China, Russia, India, South Korea, and European Union. So an initiator of these dialogues were our partners not in the Central Asia. Like US administration initiated the dialogue C5 plus one. So I think that also gives us an opportunity to develop our regional integration and cooperation as one region with our foreign partners.
I appreciate that answer, Minister. And in particular, I mean, at the Asia Society, we've always been well aware of what you pointed out about your country's place on the map. And but as you say, particularly at this moment in time, you are surrounded by, let's say, if not conflict zones, but certainly interesting situations. And I wonder if I can just follow up a little bit on that. Are there one or more of those circumstances in the region that you mentioned where you think your country has a role to play, you know, perhaps as something of a broker for a better outcome, whether, and I leave to you to choose any of those, but where do you think Kazakhstan can play that kind of role?
Yes, our foreign policy of Kazakhstan is concentrated on the multilateralism and providing the opportunity for on the global stage for all countries to solve the all conflicts by peaceful measures. like Kazakhstan, as you know, Kazakhstan provides the platform for the Astana process, as we call it. So this Astana process is aimed on the strengthening the ceasefire in Syria and to maintain the de-escalation zones. As well, also the first two rounds of the talks on the Iranian nuclear program were held in Almaty city, the first one. And upon the as a result of these all negotiations, we have the joint comprehensive plan of action on Iranian nuclear program. So our first president, Nursultan Nazarbayev, initiated a lot of initiatives in the process of denuclearization and non-proliferation. As well, we start to continue our active participation in the solving these regional and global conflicts.
Let me turn, Minister, to a couple of more questions from people watching. This comes from a viewer on YouTube, and it stays with Russia here. Some analysts are looking at the turmoil around Russia's borders. And he mentioned some areas you've mentioned, sir, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Kyrgyzstan, Ukraine, Belarus, and describing it as Russia's losing its influence in the region. As a long-term partner of Russia, what is your perspective on that analysis, and could you speak more about the Russia-Kazakhstan partnership vis-a-vis the region? Is Russia losing influence in that part of the world? That's probably a tough question for you to answer.
No, for me, it's not a tough question because we consider Russia as historical neighbor and good partner in all areas. We have common historical past. We moved from Russian Empire to Soviet Union, and after collapsing the Soviet Union, with Russia and other countries, we launched the Commonwealth of Independent States, and nowadays we have also Eurasian Economic Union. With Russia, we have the longest land border. This is the longest in the world. So this means that we very well interconnected economically, and so these serve as a base for interdependence between our two countries and economically. But politically, definitely Kazakhstan has own independent foreign policy, and on some issues we have some different views. But at the same time, we don't have any big misunderstandings or conflicts with Russia.
Thank you, sir. Shifting areas here a little bit, another question from a viewer, and I think you touched on this, Minister, in your opening remarks. Are you worried about low oil prices? Market forecasts predict continued low demand. Other major oil producing countries are having to adjust. So if we have a long-term low price in what is essentially your key commodity and export, how concerned are you, and are you adjusting in some ways?
Yes, as one of the biggest oil producer, Kazakhstan worries about the low oil prices, but at the same time, this gives new opportunities to develop our other sectors of the economy. As you may know, Kazakhstan one of the biggest uranium producer. We have huge gold mining, We have big resources in the rare earth material metals, but at the same time, as I already mentioned, that we have the national program Digital Kazakhstan, which we consider that we need towards the digital economy. So, and we need to develop at the same time IT technologies, and as I mentioned, e-sector, machinery construction, also one of the priority of our new sectors.
I guess in the same vein, a question for me now, Minister, climate change. We noticed in President Tokayev's address to the 75th edition of the UN General Assembly sessions, there was a lot of discussion of that issue. I believe he referred to climate change as profound a challenge for the world as nuclear proliferation has been. Also see that your country is issuing green bonds, I think they are, or climate bonds, a lot of financing for green initiatives. And I wonder there, given again how dependent your country historically has been on fossil fuels, how is that balance struck? And is that something you can speak more about? I mean, is there a new green wave coming to your country?
Yes, Kazakhstan is a member of the Paris Agreement. So we follow our obligations in the framework of this agreement. So by 2030, we should reduce our gas emissions by 15%. And that's why the sector of the renewable energy nowadays developing by our government. And definitely we need to decrease the fossil fuel energy sector, and we nowadays we looking to develop the nuclear energy sector to be developed. And indeed, we Kazakhstan is locating the area where is the climate change and the ecology problems have a big issue, like we have dying Aral Sea, and also we have the huge territory that was used as a Semipalatinsk nuclear test polygon, and which is we cannot use all this vast land for the agricultural purpose. So that's why we need to cooperate with international community and our neighboring countries. The special issue is the using of the transbordering river water. So we have this quadrilateral meetings between Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, and Kazakhstan. So I think that through our cooperation in the framework of the international organizations, we could find the solutions for the climate change issues.
Minister, you've been very generous with your time. I'm going to finish with a question that my guess is really not one you're going to want to answer, but I'm going to ask it anyway. The next event we have in terms of policy on this platform is on Wednesday morning, our time here in the U.S., about perspectives from Asia about the United States election. And I can't help then but ask you, you mentioned the very robust relationship, I think, that that your government, your president has had in the last few years with the Trump administration, all those examples of direct investment and relations with companies that you mentioned. And of course, I'm not going to go even near a prediction of any kind, but the polls do suggest that there may be a change at the top of the leadership in this country. Very often we hear when we come around to election cycles that countries like to keep things, you know, that they're, when the relationship is good, you don't want change. Can you say anything at all about your feelings and your country's feelings in that regard? If indeed there is a change come November here in the United States?
I'm afraid that any my word can be considered as interference in the election campaign. But I would like to say that Kazakhstan always works very closely with U.S. administration under any leadership. So the U.S. Has a special strategy on the Central Asia, and as well we have the strategical partnership between the U.S. and Kazakhstan, which is mean that the any U.S. administration will follow these policies, and definitely Kazakhstan interested for the stable, fruitful, mutually beneficial cooperation with the United States. And we have the legal frameworks between our two countries, which has put us in the right way to cooperate in future.
Spoken as a true diplomat, and I appreciate your answer, sir, and I really do appreciate the time you've given us today. And perhaps before we go, I can just send on behalf of all of us at the Asia Society continued best wishes for the way forward in terms of the coronavirus, the pandemic, and the ability of Kazakhstan to continue to mitigate those issues and those problems inside your borders and with your neighbors. And also, if I may, be among the first to wish you, I realize I'm about a year early, but all the very best for the 30th anniversary of your independence that you mentioned in the introductory remarks. Minister of Foreign Affairs Mukhtar Tileuberdi from Kazakhstan, thank you again. Rahmet.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Nagorski.
Appreciate it.